Now, the Baltimore Orioles Hot Stove Show. This is your home for Birds Baseball. WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
And welcome to it, Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL News Radio, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. Brett Hollander alongside Geoff Arnold, and this very evening, the Birdland Caravan begins. It runs through the weekend, hitting places all over Birdland to really commence the countdown for pitchers and catchers to report to Sarasota, Florida. And to that end, joining us right now, our friend and colleague from MASNSports.com, Steve Melewski. Steve, how are you?
Hey, guys, what's happening?
Well, I guess right now it feels like we're transitioning from the off season to spring training. And with the move last week, adding Cole Irvin to this rotation, I feel like a lot of boxes have been checked that the Orioles were planning on checking heading into the offseason.
Well, you know, I think so too, Brett. You know, they lost one innings eater in Jordan Lyles, and they added two in Kyle Gibson and Cole Irvin, who both the last couple years have averaged, you know, about 160, 180 innings pitched, and they've been among the league leaders in starts. And so Irvin's had a little more success via the ERA, 3.98 to 5.05. But they'll be very likely two key members of the rotation, and how that shakes out in a couple weeks in Sarasota is going to be interesting to track, because, you know, I can count just on the 40-man and some of the invitees, you know, 10, 12, 14 rotation candidates. Now, they're, you know, some are probably real long shots, and some, like, you know, Kyle Bradish and Dean Kramer are probably almost in, but there are a lot of candidates for a few spots.
Now, I was going to say, Steve, in terms of the candidates that were in the rotation mix before maybe the signings of Gibson or Irvin, I mean, you think about Kyle Bradish, you think about Dean Kramer, and then Tyler Wells too. Is there maybe one that you figure is the biggest risk of maybe coming out of the rotation with the addition of Irvin last week?
It's going to be interesting to see how that plays out, Geoff, because I think, and Mike Elias has now said this a couple times dating to last year, that Grayson Rodriguez is very likely to be in that rotation. So if he gets in, that's three. And then if you add Wells, Bradish, and Kramer, that's six. That's one too many. And I don't think they're going to go with a six-man, but I guess that's within the realm of possibility. So someone might have to be bumped back. And to me, Wells is an obvious candidate, not that he is the least of the six, but that he has done the relief gig, as we know. And I just think having one or two guys, and both maybe another, who can give you two or three innings in mid-relief, 5-6-7, 6-7-8, 6-7, something like that, to bridge to the late-inning guys is big in the American League. Those are innings when a lot of games are won or lost. You haven't yet gotten to your studs 8-9, and your starter tired out in the sixth, and now how are you going to cover a few outs there? And those are always critical outs, and sometimes games swing in those innings.
And we know there'll be a handful of bullpen games, and we know there'll be injuries, unfortunately. But to your point, Steve, I kind of like both. Maybe Deal Hall, who could also swing to the late innings, and Mike Bauman, who could also swing to late innings. In that bridge role, maybe it's planned on certain days, because we also know that Kramer, and particularly Bradish, Wells, and Rodriguez, are going to be on some pretty strict innings limits again this year.
They may well be, and that's going to be interesting to see how that plays out. If history is an indicator, the Orioles and most teams are not likely to tip their hand and put a number on it that they announce to the public and the media, but they'll be watching it closely. I mean, just look at Grayson, 75, 80 innings last year, and if you make 30 starts times 5 innings, that's 150. And 30 starts might get you to the beginning of the end of the season, and you know they're not going to want to shut him down early. You know that. So they're going to have to massage that somehow with Grayson, whether it's some short starts early, whether it is skipping them once or twice. You know, there are ways to do it, and they're going to have to find those ways with some of these guys.
We're with Masson's Steve Melewski on Orioles Hot Stove. In terms of massaging innings, D.L. Hall and Grayson are kind of in the same boat. And with DL's success that he had in the bullpen last year, the Orioles have said previously that maybe he could go into the starting rotation coming into this year, and they have an open mind as far as what they're going to do with him. But it seems to me, Steve, like his contributions to the bullpen at the end of last year, number one, are too good to ignore. And number two, if you're going to maybe be managing starting pitching innings, it might just be best to do it with one of your prospects as opposed to two.
Exactly. And here's another thing, Geoff, that we're all going to have to start thinking about and maybe talking more to Mike Elias and Brandon Hyde about. How do they maneuver call-ups and handle some of these top prospects? Because now if you're in win mode and your goal is the playoffs, and they've stated that it is, that's very different maybe how you handle some of these guys than you would if you're only going to win 65 games. Very different. Think of Manny Machado, called up from AA. In August of, I forget what year it was now, but he was called up in AA. He never played a single game in AAA. So I'm not saying we'll see something like that, although we could. And it could impact a pitcher like Hall, who maybe you realize those one or two innings he can impact in the bullpen is so big. And at the same time, the kid's got such an array of pitches, and they're all quality. Just commanding them has always been an issue, at least consistent command. But some of these decisions may be made differently moving forward than they were looking back.
Steve Melewski is with us. An interesting guy in the Orioles bullpen. And it's interesting because you can see what he provides. And he had a fascinating year last year in Keegan Aiken, who had truly a dominant first half. And you've been following and covering Keegan for a long time. We're talking about someone who had a 2.36 ERA the first half of the year with a very, very low whip number, walks way down, strikeouts actually down too. And then the second half of the season, an ERA of 4.76, and everything that went up, you would expect, went along with that. Batting average, slugging, OPS, all against him, way up in the second half of the season. Is he someone you think who has to earn his way into that bullpen, or does the first half of last year and the fact he's left-handed secure a spot?
I think it's hard to say it's secure because, you know, there are probably four or five who already fit that bill in the bullpen, and now you're starting to get to the end, and it's hard to just say definite, you know? I think they're going to need to see him look more like the first half. Keegan, when he was really in attack mode, he was throwing strike one, he was working fast, and whatever happened, whether hitters adjusted to that in the second half or his stuff waned a little bit, he's going to have to find a way to make that last through the year. And, I mean, he's one of those key bullpen guys. And a bullpen that does is not overloaded with lefties. It's probably a good time for Keegan to have a big spring.
We are with Steve Melewski from MASNSports.com. Much more as we continue, including Terrin Vavra on Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL.
Keep it here during the offseason for the latest news and updates on Birds baseball. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Hey, O's fans, did you see every Birdland membership comes with an exclusive members-only Adley Rutschman Celebration bobblehead? A variety of membership options are available, including the all-new Flex membership. Plus, each membership receives immediate access to opening day tickets. Learn more at Orioles.com/memberships.
That's Geoff. I'm Brett. This is Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. We have Terrin Vavra joining us at 7:35 with us right now is MASNSports.com's Steve Melewski. And what's so obvious to me, Steve, going back to the roster, we talked about the rotation and the bullpen. There's going to be some really tough decisions pretty much everywhere, unlike the last few years when you were really entrenched in the hardest parts of a rebuild. You look at the totality of the 26-man roster and who will be left out. Backups and utility players are so much better than they have been in recent years. James McCann will be Adley Rutschman's backup. Ramon Urias could be your utility infielder. Someone like Terrin Vavra, who I actually liked a lot last year, we're going to speak to him coming up. He's a very fringy player right now as far as making this ball club, and he brings a lot to the table, in my opinion.
He does. I like his hitting approach, a gap-to-gap guy, really can work the count, patient, knows the strike zone. We know he's not going to bring power, so we can't really downgrade him for that. It's just not his calling card. It's not a tool he brings, but he brings some defensive versatility, obviously speed. And, you know, that the pedigree of his family and his dad, you know, all those years as a hitting coach, you see that when you watch Vavra bat. He's very calm in there. He's very relaxed in the Major League clubhouse. He's confident but not cocky. So he's a great guy to have there. And as you mentioned, though, his spot is not secure. The competition is so tough. And I guess, guys, that comes along with winning 83 games and having a more complete roster. And as you look at the NRI list that came out today, it's hard to see a lot of those guys making it. And so that's a tribute to the Orioles getting better and deeper as an organization.
And Steve, you said it in one of your columns that this is a very bad year to be a non-roster invite to Orioles spring training. Very different than, you know, I think back to what that list looked like 2 years ago. Last year it felt different, but this year it's much different than even it was last March. Is there maybe a player or two from that non-roster list that you think has a chance, maybe a chance to crack this Orioles roster?
One I wrote about recently was Nomar Mazara, who's got a pedigree of being a bonus baby when he was signed internationally, got nearly $5 million back in the day at age 16. He had 20 homers his first 3 years in the bigs, 19 his fourth, left-handed hitter, corner outfield. So he's got a bit of a resume, was once fifth for the Rookie of the Year, and yet he's going to have to make this roster as a reserve, which he's been the last couple of years, and maybe the Orioles will like having a fourth or fifth outfielder who can hit the ball out, DH one night, you know, spot in to rest guys, and yet they already have three starters that we know that they like, not to mention Stowers and McKenna. That's five right there. So, again, hard for Mazzara or anybody else to make it. Daz Cameron's a pretty good defender, once highly drafted by Mike Elias a couple years ago. So there are some guys who will be intriguing to watch on this list. You know, a couple guys from the Oriole minors who've flown under the radar the last few years, arms they really like. Morgan McSweeney and Cade Stroud come to mind. Ryan Watson was their minor league pitcher of the year. He's an NRI. And there are a bunch of guys who fans probably haven't heard much about or know much about, and that might include us too. Some of the minor league signees we'll get to learn more about as they all report to Florida. But it's going to be an interesting camp, Geoff, but you're right. Maybe less spots to be won, barring surprises. And here's the other thing. Over the years, and this, maybe this will change this year, but Mike Elias and Brandon Hyde have not seemed to me to put major stock in spring training stats. That doesn't mean the roster is set before they play a spring game, but if a guy hits 410, it may not turn their heads as much as maybe in some other camps with rebuilding teams.
Steve Melewski from MASNSports.com is with us. And Steve, you've been covering the Orioles minor leagues and prospect lists as close as anybody for a very, very long time. We've just been inundated with about 10 prospect lists. I remember the days when we get one, and that was a big deal. Now we have about 10 to look at, and they're all pretty much littered with Baltimore Orioles. And that's after graduating Adley Rutschman to the big leagues. And not only is it high in volume, it's high in the upper echelon of most of these lists, with Gunnar Henderson usually at one and Grayson Rodriguez not far behind him. Have you ever seen this organization's farm system do this well in any of these lists in your time covering it?
I have not. And I was talking to, and you've got to be an older guy, older than you two, and maybe my age bracket, to remember the days when Bobby Gritch and Don Baylor had a hard time making the Orioles late 60s, early 70s, because the major league team was so good. Don Baylor won IL MVP 1 year, and the next year played like 120 games back at AAA Rochester. It was that hard to break through. And so maybe that's I think to that era, but we didn't rank players then. You know, we didn't have lists like this. So getting 11 different Orioles that have gotten top 100 recognition by one or more major outlets is absolutely fantastic. I've never seen anything like it. They're clearly ranked number one. It's almost a consensus number one. There are other teams challenging them. Arizona's got a lot of highly ranked players, but most analysts concur the Orioles are number one on the farm right now.
Wrapping things up here with Masson's Steve Melewski, because of those lists, and because of all the players that the Orioles have, not only in the top 100, but up and down their farm system, it's still, to me, Steve, in the back of my mind, you wonder, does this team go out and maybe try and get somebody else via trade? After you had Irvin last week, you help fix your problem of maybe having enough innings for your starting pitchers. Irvin's an innings eater, but you know, another thing coming into the offseason was going to be the bat, and could you maybe get an impact bat? Do you think that there is a chance that maybe somewhere on the position player side and with the prospect capital the team has, that maybe they're not done yet?
Maybe they're not, and maybe Geoff, even if they are sort of done for opening day 2023, there's going to be a trade deadline mid-year. And if the Orioles are contending, they certainly hope they are, then they'll know a little more about their roster, where it's thin, where one key addition might be enough to push them over the hump. And that might be the time to strike with that major package, and they'll have the depth to do it. So, I mean, this depth they have now, it's not going to go away, and some others may emerge to join this group, how they play early in the year. So they're well positioned to make a deal, whether it's a March deal or a July deal, to help the Major League team moving forward. And prospect capital probably has never been more valued in the game. So it's a great time to have a great farm.
Yeah, no question about that. Geoff and I will have more on that later, how the Orioles could be the first team in the pool at the next phase of things, which will be during the season and when trades happen then. But Steve Melewski from MASNSports.com, we appreciate so much, Steve, and we'll catch up very soon.
You got it, guys. Thanks.
That is Steve Melewski. Orioles infielder, outfielder, prospect Terrin Vavra joins us coming up as we continue on Hot Stove on WBAL. Orioles Hot Stove on a Thursday night on WBAL News Radio, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. And Geoff, Birdland Caravan begins tonight, Beller High School, and Mike Elias, Orioles Executive Vice President and General Manager, and Orioles skipper Brandon Hyde there. Tell us about your event coming up this weekend.
Well, my event is going to be at Wild Lake High School in Columbia, so from 2 to 3 o'clock. Nick Vespi, D.L. Hall, Grayson Rodriguez, and Brandon Hyde are all going to be there, so we'll do a Q&A session with them. Fans can come, enjoy meeting some of these different prospects and get their questions answered. Brad, I also understand there are some games that we will be playing.
Yes.
At our caravan events. We always love the games, and I think that probably for your session, I'm going to guess fans are going to have a few more questions at this Birdland Caravan that you're going to be going to. But for us, especially Grayson Rodriguez and D.L. Hall, as good of friends as they are, and Nick Vespi being a fun guy, along with Brandon Hyde, I think it should make for a fun fan Q&A, as well as some of these games, which I figure will be pretty hilarious.
You know, Pat Sajak is a local and a diehard Orioles fan, so we have to channel our inner Pat Sajak skill set of hosting game shows to pull off the caravan on our end. But that should be a whole lot of fun. Great events happening throughout the region all weekend long for the Birdland Caravan. We'll come back with Terrin Vavra, who I thought made a really positive impression on the club when he got called up last year. Terrin Vavra next year on Orioles Hot Stove.
Give the gift of opening day with a Birdland membership. Buy any Birdland membership now and receive priority access to opening day tickets versus the Yankees. Go to Orioles.com/memberships. Now, more of the Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
Birdland Caravan is back this weekend. Birdland Caravan brings Orioles baseball to your hometown. Interact with the team through free fan rallies and happy hours. Plus, autograph sessions are on sale now, featuring Cedric Mullins, Felix Bautista, Austin Hayes, Terrin Vavra, and more. Learn more at Orioles.com/caravan.
Who did you just say there, Geoff? Terrin who?
That would be Terrin Vavra.
Terrin Vavra, the pride of the University of Minnesota, and Mr. Vavra joins us right now. Terrin, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you guys doing?
We're doing well. How's your off-season going?
It's good. Yeah, I just actually got down to Sarasota, so now it's go time.
Well, that's great to hear, Terrin. I mean, you're in Sarasota now. You're going to be coming up to Baltimore for the caravan over this weekend. I looked at some of the events you're doing. You're doing O's Bowling. You're doing autographs at Bowie State on Saturday, and then a happy hour at Checker Spot. The group that you're bowling with, in addition to great Orioles fans, Mike Elias, Heston Kerstad, Adley Ramon Urias, of that group, who do you think is the best bowler? You can say yourself, you know, by the way.
You know, I know I don't. I surely don't think it's myself. I just think that Adley's kind of a man of many talents, and I just feel like bowling is going to be, you know, one of those talents that he's also good at. So I'll give Adley the nod, but I wouldn't be surprised if Ramon or Heston hold their own too.
Terrin, how would you assess your first taste of big league baseball, about 100 plate appearances, 40 games? How would you assess your performance?
Well, I think that there's, you know, room for improvement without a doubt, first and foremost. But I think the encouraging part was I didn't feel out of place. I felt like, you know, there's a lot of guys that welcomed me in and, you know, showed me a lot of support and made my experience pretty positive. A lot of my experience, you know, in that little stretch was positive, and not everyone can say that when they, you know, get their first taste of the big leagues. And I'm just pretty proud. I'm pretty happy looking back, but also excited for what's ahead.
We're with Terrin Vavra, Orioles player, who's going to be part of the caravan this weekend. Geoff and Brett on Orioles Hot Stove. Terrin, kind of in that same vein, based on what your first experience was like in the major leagues, what have been your key focuses this offseason going into spring training?
Well, I think, you know, we got a lot of talented guys, and I'm just trying to, you know, go value any way I can. So being able to play every position, you know, just somewhere where I can plug in and get in the lineup and you know, contribute and help the team win. That's kind of what I'm, you know, excited to be doing going into this year. And, you know, just working on this offseason, just spending time at different positions and making sure I'm ready to go. So at the drop of the hat, I can fill in and help the team.
Terrin, you hit your first big league home run on the last day of the regular season this past year, and it came in game one of a doubleheader. How nice was it to not go into the offseason sitting on zero big league home runs?
Yeah, it's definitely nice to kind of take a deep breath after that happened. It wasn't something that, you know, I wasn't going up there necessarily trying to do, and I'm not that type of player where, you know, it's a huge part of my game, but good to be able to show it, and, you know, hopefully there's a lot more of that in the future.
Terrin, how much do you pay attention to moves that the Orioles make in the offseason, as well as maybe some of the prospect lists that advertise a lot of the other really good players in the Orioles minor league system? Are you paying attention to that, and does that affect you at all, or are you kind of just ignoring the noise and going about your business as usual?
I think that's, you know, just part of the business. There's always going to be someone, you know, coming up behind you. There's always going to be new guys that are brought in. So, you know, having that, you know, experience, knowing that stuff's going to keep happening. But also, like, I've been fortunate enough to play with a lot of the guys coming up, and I know how talented they are. And I know, you know, how good each of those, you know, individual prospects can be. I don't think that's anything that really is, you know, too stressful or anything, because you want the best for your organization. You want the best for your team. And ultimately, they're a great group of guys to play with. So there's never any sort of, you know, stress or anything. It's just all part of the game.
Orioles infielder, outfielder Terrin Vavra with us here on Hot Stove on WBAL. Terrin, you are a legitimate 300 hitter in the minor leagues. Very few guys can say that, especially these days. You're someone who sprays the ball around, and you're someone who may not be impacted that much by the shift. But I'm curious, someone whose dad was a major league hitting coach, and your real approach to hitting being just so sound, how do you think it's going to impact both you and the game?
I think it's going to have a, you know, a bigger impact than a lot of people might expect. You know, there's holes everywhere. You know, with the shift, there's, you know, big parts of the field that they're leaving open, and then now with them limiting that, there'll be other, you know, spots for balls to get through. So I think it'll impact, you know, the game quite a bit. But at the same point, it kind of gets back to, you know, traditional baseball and, you know, playing yourself as an infielder, just lining up a little bit more traditionally. It might be nice to kind of get back in there and not feel, you know, so far from second base or so far from first base, like wherever you're playing. It might be nice to, you know, kind of be back where you kind of grew up playing.
Terrin, I'm going to change gears on you here. You may or may not know this about Brett, but he is a musical connoisseur. I remember that when we were in New York, we were talking to you about your sister-in-law, who's an actress and was in Six the Musical. Brett looked this up. Apparently, Six is coming to Baltimore in May. Is your sister-in-law gonna be in Baltimore to participate? And have you gotten to see the musical?
I have definitely got to see the musical plenty of times. It's a great show. Unfortunately, my sister-in-law is not still with Six. She's pursuing other opportunities, she's doing her thing. She's killing it. So really proud of her. But no, she won't be in Baltimore. She had a great experience with Six, but everybody's got the next step, and she's kind of in that phase. So
very cool. Well, that would have been fun for you and your teammates. I know a few of them went in on Broadway during that last trip to New York, but that would have been fun to have a group go to a theater in Baltimore to see your sister-in-law in a musical. But Terrin Vavra, we appreciate so much. Have fun this weekend with the Birdland Caravan, and we'll see you in Sarasota in a few weeks.
All right, sounds good. Excited to be up in Baltimore and getting to spend some time with the fans. So thanks, guys, for having me.
That is Terrin Vavra. Interesting guy to watch when spring training rolls around in just a few short weeks. More still to come as we continue on Hot Stove on WBAL.
Follow the Orioles on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Learn more at Orioles.com/connect. Now back to the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
O's fans, the 2023 promo schedule is available at Orioles.com. Fan favorites are back, including the floppy hat, a Brett Hollander favorite, and Birdland Hawaiian shirt. More bobbleheads than ever, highlighted by an Adley Rutschman bobblehead inspired by Captain America. Plus, the Orioles soccer jersey, caps, t-shirts, and more. Learn more at Orioles.com/promotions and be the first to select your games for a Birdland membership.
Hey, it's coming. You have one NFL game to go. It's February. Pitchers and catchers are reporting around the corner. We have the Birdland Caravan starting tonight. So, Jeffrey, I ordered my Bob Carpenter scorebook the other day. It's en route to my home in Baltimore. So that means it's time to get packed soon.
You're doing the full Bob Carpenter scorebook. You're not just picking up where you left off from last year. You do a separate scorebook a year.
I do a separate scorebook. I have a few pages left. I usually do a carryover, but I kind of like the neatness of keeping one per season. I'm hoping to have extra room this year that would go towards, I don't know, maybe a postseason game or two. That's kind of the goal when you buy the big book. But what do? Do you carry over?
I do not carry over. I would maybe save my old books in case I did. I think maybe one year I did actually a carryover for like spring training games, but then I got out of that habit. So I do a new one every year myself, and I make sure I order enough pages just in case the Orioles are in the postseason this year.
Yeah, sounds good to me. By the way, this is Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL, brought to you by NJM Insurance. No jingles or mascots, just great insurance. Let's go back over what was announced today, the Orioles non-roster invitee list to spring training. 11 pitchers, 4 catchers, 10 infielders, and 5 outfielders. What names jump out to you, Jeff?
I mean, the two, Brett, and we heard Steve Melewski talk about one in Nomar Mazar, who was formerly a top prospect when he was with the Texas Rangers. And he had a 4-year stretch where he was hitting maybe 19, 20 home runs a year. He had one year recently where defensively he was not bad. But he's not on the 40-man roster, and I just think it's going to be really hard to try and crack the group this year. This is not the 2020 or 2021 non-roster invite list. I mean, these are some really good prospects, but even so, you figure that guys like Jordan Westberg or Connor Norby, it's going to take a little bit longer for them to reach the major leagues just because of the guys who are already in front of them. Another name, Brett, and maybe he should get a little bit more consideration for no other reason than he was DFA'd 5 times, is Lewin Diaz, who's pretty good defensively, but battles the same problem as Mazara. Major league time, but just not much in the way of roster spots available.
I can't wait to meet Lewin Diaz. I'm just so excited to meet someone who's become kind of a cult hero in many ways. Someone who's
been on so many rosters at this point. Did you get mad after the second or the third DFA, or do you realize that it's just part of the business?
Do you know where you are right now, Mr. Diaz? No, I can't wait to meet him. That's probably high on my list. Obviously, when I look at this non-roster invite list, I'm most excited to see the prospects. I hope I get to see Jackson Holliday play some shortstop, Kobe Mayo play some third. Clearly, the guys who are upper
levels of the minor leagues, like a Jordan Westberg and Connor Norby. That's exciting as well. And I remember watching Manny Machado in the spring of 2012, not thinking at all at the age of 19 he could reach the big leagues. Not only did he reach the big leagues, he reached the big leagues in the middle of a pennant race. So you never know. So that's exciting. But to your point, Geoff, this is not the last few years. I'm not sure if one of these players cracked the opening day 26. Maybe one. Now, we'll see guys on this list at some point, particularly on the pitching side. There's always going to be injuries. And then some of the catchers that are here, as those things go, you imagine you'll see at least one of them in Anthony Benboom, who was on the opening day roster last year, or someone like Maverick Hanley, who is maybe Adley's long-term backup. So those are interesting things to look at. We made a point earlier in the show with Steve Melewski. Steve really made this point, and I think this is very true right now. When you look at where the Orioles are and what they held on to this offseason as far as prospects go, right now maybe 25 clubs think they can contend this year, Geoff. Right now, as things are constituted. Now, a lot of that is trying to save face with their fan bases as we approach opening day. But let's just say 24, 25 clubs feel they can make the playoffs. That number dwindles from the second game of the season on. And by the time July 1st or the end of June rolls around, it's a much smaller number. And really good players become available by trade. And the Orioles have the most they can move right now. They'll have the most they can move of any other club come June, come July, to make a big splash. So if they have an obvious deficiency and they're really contending, expect the Orioles to be active at that stage of this.
The other thing you have to factor in too, Brett, is just consider that there will probably be a prospect or two or more in your system who will come out of nowhere and have a huge year. Like Connor Norby was that player last year for the Orioles who not super high on any of the Orioles prospect lists. So it means that maybe you're going to trade a player like that who can allow you to not have to worry about trading somebody at the very top part of your list. It's going to depend on the type of player that if you make a deal that you're going to be dealing for, but the amount of depth that you have, as well as the possibility somebody might come out of nowhere and you realize this player is good, but there are also players in front of them who we think are better. That player that maybe suddenly jumps out could appeal to another team that could help you address the need that you have. I want to also say, Brett, that one of the things I'm excited to see, Jackson Holliday was on my list, but another thing is seeing Cade Povich, who just made it onto Kylie McDaniel's ESPN top 100 list the other day. We know what Grayson Rodriguez is. We know what D.L. Hall is, but I think we're all wondering a little bit, who is the next group of quality pitchers in the Orioles minor league system, because it is such a position player dominant group. Who's maybe the next pitcher that could have an impact on this rotation or in this bullpen? Povich seems like he could be one of those players, along with maybe somebody like Ryan Watson. So Povich in particular was a name that I was looking forward to seeing get some spring training innings.
Yeah, I think that is a really good point. Well, we will come back. We'll wrap things up next here on Hot Stove on WBAL. Well, that does it for this edition of Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL. We are back next Thursday, February 9, as we get closer and closer to spring training. If everyone is going out this weekend to catch a caravan event, enjoy it. We want to hear all about it. We can't wait to be a part of it. Big thank you to Steve Melewski from MASNSports.com, also Terrin Vavra, Chris Carlheim, and the one and only Big Al Hildebeindl back at WBAL.